the Baltic coastline. Primeval and wild. Some of its inhabitants come from the south, others from the north of Europe. They all live on the Baltic Sea. The islands offer breeding grounds for many kinds of seabird and are islands of hope for other almost extinct species. The Curonian Spit in Lithuania. The dunes, some over 70 meters tall, are among the highest in Europe. Like a sickle made of sand, the spit separates the open Baltic Sea from the wide bay of the lagoon. A natural dam, 98 kilometers long, at some points only 400 meters wide. In the lagoon, the fresh water of the Nemunas River collects as in a shallow basin, three times bigger than Lake Constance, but barely 6 meters deep. It's spring. Young white-tailed eagles have discovered a dead fish. The birds still have their darker adolescent plumage. After the long winter, the birds begrudge each other even the smallest titbit, and bitter squabbles are the result. Their claws are as sharp as daggers and can cause nasty cuts. To intimidate their opponents, the birds spread their wings wide. Fighting eagles sometimes get so tangled up in each other that they can no longer disengage, and both birds die. It's clear who the victor is in this battle. The Curonian Spit consists mainly of sand. In the early 17th century, the dunes were thickly wooded. Later, the trees were cleared. Then the sand began to move. Baltic Sea winds drove the wandering dunes northwards towards the lagoon, burying 14 villages. Nothing and no one could hold back the constantly shifting sands. Planting beach grass didn't help. Not until 1870, when new trees were planted, could the dunes be halted. By which time, the fishing village of Nida, right on the lagoon, had already been moved twice. Today, the Curonian pennants follow the breeze. Once they were attached to the masts of fishing boats. Now they indicate the wind direction and the fisherman's home port. Sixty kilometers further north are the endless sandy beaches of Latvia. Directly behind the coastal woods lies Lake Papa. The swampy former beach lake is in many places only 30 centimeters deep, Over time, it would become ever more overgrown with reeds and finally disappear. To prevent this, large hooved animals have been introduced into the nature reserve to conserve the landscape. Heck cattle and Koniks, descendants of Europe's last wild horses. It is mainly the robust Koniks that keep the reeds down and dig up their roots in winter, which grazing sheep would not be able to. In the meantime, large herds have formed that are almost wild and do not need feeding. Koniks are a primeval race of Polish ponies. At barely 1 meter 40 tall, they recall tarpans, an extinct race of European wild horses. It's the end of May. The foals are just 3 weeks old. For them, trials of strength are still a game. For others, they're for real. A stallion is fleaming, picking up the scent of the mares. Soon after giving birth, they're ready to mate again. Then the stallions become competitors. They beat on the ground with their hooves to intimidate their rivals. The tension is transmitted to the herd. Some stallions still bear the scars of earlier confrontations. If the warnings are ignored, the wild horses begin a grim battle. One powerful kick can break bones. The herd is getting restless. The mare on heat is being hustled and chased by several stallions simultaneously, all of which want to get as close as possible so that they can father her next foal. The foal's fall looks dramatic. Fortunately, it's quickly on its feet again, without getting caught under the flying hooves. For now, mare and foal are reunited. Today, the Papa Nature Reserve has a population of over 100 Koniks. Without them, the open spaces with their orchids and meadow birds would soon be covered by woodlands. To the north, untouched sandy beaches extend along the Latvian coast. Wild and uninhabited. On the dunes and in the hinterland grow sparse pine woods. This is probably how it used to look on the Curonian Spit. Conifers and dense blueberry undergrowth in sandy earth, low in nutrients. The delicate flowers of the round-leaved wintergreen smell of lily of the valley. The sand carnation prefers dry areas. as does the greater butterfly orchid. The woods beyond the dunes are home to European rollers. Once they were ruthlessly hunted for their plumage. Today the roller is mostly to be found in southern Europe. In the breeding season, it prefers a warm, dry environment, like here in the woods on the Latvian coast. Mosses and pixie cups with their red fruit thrive in the barren soil. Every spring, the crow-sized rollers return from East Africa to Latvia, their most northerly breeding ground. With tumbling nosedives, the male roller marks the perimeters of its territory. Perhaps it was this behavior that gave the birds their name. To cement their bond, the male gives his mate a wedding present of a cockchafer. Rollers mainly eat large beetles, crickets, and butterflies, which are becoming ever rarer in Europe. One reason why these birds are also becoming more scarce. In the 1970s, the Baltic had a population of thousands of rollers. Now only 20 pairs breed in Latvia, anxiously monitored by ornithologists. The present has the desired effect. Unable to make their own nest holes, rollers depend on finding disused dwellings of other birds. Thanks to the rings fitted by ornithologists, we know that the oldest Latvian roller has been nesting here for 27 years. Slippery plastic foil is a barrier against predators plundering the eggs. Nesting boxes have been attached to the trees far enough apart to prevent pine martens from getting at them. Latvian nature conservationists use every trick in the book to keep these colourful birds coming back. Europe's largest species of cat also brings up its young here, with a population of around 500 in Latvia. The lynx. About 3 weeks ago, a mother animal gave birth to her offspring under a fallen tree. The cub was born with hair, but only opened its eyes a few days ago. Now it wants to find out more about the outside world. Under the strict supervision of its mother, of course. She will suckle her cub for 10 weeks. Within a few days, the young lynx will be eating meat and, at the age of 6 or 7 months, undertake its first attempts at hunting. Next year, cub and mother will go their separate ways. First steps to independence. For the mother, however, enough curiosity is enough. If a gentle nudge doesn't have the desired effect of getting the little one to go back, only a gentle bite in the neck area will help. And at once the cub goes into carry-me mode. Motionless, the cub hangs from its mother's mouth, allowing it to be transported painlessly. The best place for it at the moment is deep inside the cozy den. Western Latvia, which extends to the Baltic Sea and the Bay of Riga, is called Kurzeme. The coast is lined by dune woods and long sandy beaches, which are deserted even in summer. Occasionally, steep cliffs of clay up to 30 meters high tower over the beach. In many places, they're peppered with holes. Tunneled by sand martins. Europe's smallest species of swallow has just returned from Africa. In pairs, the birds check if the old holes in the cliff face are still suitable for nesting. Sand martins are gregarious birds and congregate in large flocks, even away from breeding grounds. This colony is home to about 500 pairs. Their nesting tunnels are as long as a human arm, rising towards the end and opening out into a nesting area upholstered with grass and feathers. This pair has found a suitable hole. But they're too late. The nesting tube is already taken, and the occupants have no intention of giving it up. The other tubes also have crowds of interested potential tenants. And those martins already in possession of a hole should on no account leave their new home unguarded. Beyond the beach, Kurzeme is characterized by expansive meadows rich in species, along with the occasional farm. In mid-June, when the cuckoo can be heard calling, the fields glow with the bright flowers of the ragged robin and the field cowheat. Marsh orchids are in bloom. The meadows are inhabited by some impressive insects, like the rose gold beetle. Without such colourful blooms and blossoms, Latvia's most important festival of the year could not be celebrated. Midsummer night. The day before, when the sun is at its highest, all over the country flowers are picked. According to legend, the healing powers of grasses and flowers collected on Herb Day are particularly effective. During the summer, the anteater bird is active in the greenery. The wryneck. It's searching for ants, available here in abundance. Its 6 centimeter long sticky tongue is ideal for fishing out insects and larvae. Its chicks are almost fully fledged and are waiting in an old fruit tree. Wrynecks usually live in tree holes or old woodpecker nests. Eleven chicks are waiting to be fed. Every day, the parents have to deliver 10,000 ant larvae to fill their hungry beaks. The wryneck takes its name from its ability to turn its head more than 180 degrees, which it does either when performing mating rituals or when it feels threatened. The meadows in Kurzeme are also home to elks. In 1998, there were still 8,000 in Latvia, but their numbers are shrinking. Winters in the Baltic are becoming warmer and shorter, meaning that plants are starting to grow earlier in the year, And when the young elks eat their first herbs, they're no longer as nutritious. Old greens aren't as easy to digest, with the result that the calves grow more slowly and have a harder time getting through the winter. This may be one reason that the elk population is falling. It is midsummer. On farms all over the country, flowers are being woven into garlands. Such headdresses are not only designed to protect humans from evil, animals and buildings are also decorated. Some farmsteads offer shelter for particular animals. A hoopoe has made its nest in a crack in a wall. Like the rollers, they live mainly on large insects such as mole crickets. The chicks are fed for 30 days in the nest, then for another week outside, before they leave the farmstead. The wooded dunes of Saaremaa, location of Latvia's most beautiful beaches. The shortest night of the year, the summer solstice, begins. The locals celebrate with singing and dancing on the beach. Traditionally, the men wear oak leaves in their hair, while the women decorate themselves with garlands of flowers. The celebrations continue on the beach until sunset, thereafter in the farmsteads until the small hours. Sunrise over Cape Kolka in Latvia. The tip of the cape is where the Baltic Sea meets the Bay of Riga. Thirty kilometers further north lies Estonia, land of the 1521 islands. Most of them are minute, but still highly desirable resting places. For Baltic grey seals, for instance. 100 years ago, there were more than 100,000 here. They were driven almost to extinction by fishermen worried about too much competition. Adult grey seals need an average of 10 kilos of fish a day. Even fast fish like salmon or cod are no problem for the agile seals. Since no longer being hunted, they have lost their shyness and their numbers have increased again. Nowadays, the northern Baltic is home to more than 20,000 grey seals. Occasionally, a few young seals even turn up on the German coast, where they have long since ceased to be native. This seal in Estonia's Vilsandi National Park knows where it's going. Far out to sea, there's an old wreck. The perfect spot for grey seals. It combines a remote hunting ground with a sun deck to chill on. But sadly, the wreck is no longer an inside tip. In this way, the fishermen have created a place in the sun for their old rivals. Island number 1522 in the Estonian Baltic Sea. Two-thirds of the Vilsandi National Park lie in the sea and consist of more than 150 islands and islets, ideal for grey seals to sun themselves on. Some are nesting places for colonies of birds. For Caspian terns, for example, the biggest in Europe, with a wingspan of almost 1.5 meters. The first chicks have already hatched and are now waiting impatiently for fresh fish. Almost 60 pairs of terns nest on the island. The parents brood alternately for about 3 weeks. Often there's only about a meter of room between nests, which can lead to trouble with the neighbors. The chicks only eat fish. After several patient attempts, the fat morsel is finally delivered to the hungry offspring. Living in a colony has its advantages. In times of danger, all the birds take off at once, which puzzles predators and distracts them from the chicks in the nests. This time, however, it was a false alarm. The terns were confused by a passing swan. In summer, the grey seals love to just lie around and doze in the sun. They've started molting. Because their skin cells are now suffused with blood, their coat itches. At this time of year, the seals need the warmth of the sun. If they had to spend all day in the water, because of the molt, they would lose a lot of heat. The rocks in the Vilsandi National Park are thus highly sought after. The last warm rays at the end of the day are particularly desirable. Those as yet without a rock now try their luck with subterfuge. The current occupant can twist and turn as it likes. Its colleague in the water is so pushy that at some point it simply gives in. Estonia, the land of islands. The 50-meter-high Saaremaa lighthouse stands at the southernmost tip of Saaremaa, the biggest island in the country. Just 40,000 people live in an area the size of Luxembourg. The Panga Cliff, with its 20-meter-high escarpments. An impressive wall of limestone that stretches through the whole of northern Estonia and can be seen particularly well here. The limey soil is perfect for rare plants. The oak woods at Lude are home to 14 different kinds of orchid. Lady's slipper is especially abundant. It can take 10 or even 15 years for an orchid to flower. The slipper-like bloom is a trap for insects. Lured by scent and colour, there's only one way out, and when they find it, the insects automatically pollinate the orchid. Unspoiled habitat, pristine streams. At the end of the 1990s, the neighbouring island of Hiiumaa was the scene of a very special conservation project. Here, the European mink was given a chance of survival. There are now only about 1,000 left in Europe, after the animal had been hunted for centuries for its fur, its habitat cultivated by man, and rivers straightened. There are unspoiled streams on Hiiumaa where the mink can hunt small rodents, fish, and crustaceans. Along the banks, in crevices and among tree roots, the mink dig out dens where they give birth. The litter of 5, 6, or sometimes as many as 10 babies are tiny at birth. Weighing less than 10 grams, they only open their eyes after 5 weeks. That European mink have been born on Hiiumaa is a major success. American mink were farmed for years for their silky coats, and escapees from the farms had driven out the weaker local mink. At the end of the 1990s, nature conservationists caught all the American mink on Hiiumaa and reintroduced the European species, which has been able to multiply ever since. Autumn is approaching. The elks arrive at their rutting grounds. For more than 500 years, the lighthouse at Kirpu on Hiiumaa has shown mariners the way along the tricky coastline. The bishop's castle in Kurasare on Saaremaa was built in 1381 and is one of the best preserved medieval citadels in the Baltic. On the mainland, east of Tallinn, lies the Saaremaa National Park, the land of the bays. The coast is marked by hundreds of rocks and boulders. Every year, thousands of cranes stop over here. The huge boulders offer shelter from wind and waves. Flying is a thirsty business. As the seawater this far north contains scarcely any salt, the cranes can drink it without qualms. The birds spend the night in knee-deep water. That way they're safe from predators like foxes or wild boars. While some take an extended bath, others stick their necks out to make sure the coast is clear. The more watchful eyes, the better. If an eagle attacked, for instance, they would sound the alarm and close ranks. Latecomers join their fellow cranes until late in the night. As dawn breaks, the older and younger birds gather their strength one more time and then take off together. Cranes are early risers. The first birds leave before dawn and then give the signal for the others to follow. They have a long journey before them. They're heading for the Bosphorus and then Egypt. To Latvia. In the Bay of Riga, far offshore, stands the lighthouse of Cape Kolka. Where the open Baltic Sea meets the Bay of Riga lies the Slitere National Park. Here the brown moor water of the Irbe flows into the Baltic Sea. The river's sandbanks change their position from year to year. In late autumn, fish move up the Irbe to lay their eggs. Brown trout. While swimming upstream, they live on their reserves of fat. Related to the salmon, the fish cover up to 40 kilometers a day. They're emaciated when they reach the spawning area. The females dig a trench with their tail fins in which to lay their eggs, closely followed by the males, who then fertilize the eggs. In contrast to salmon, the fish do not die after performing their arduous trek, but swim back to the sea to return again next year. The bar-tailed godwits have come down from the northern tundra. They use their long beaks to extract sandhoppers from the shore. One more rest, then they'll fly south for the winter and leave the Baltic coasts to the autumn storms, which are already brewing. The water boils in gale-force winds. Whatever's on the seabed is churned up by the waves, dislodging seaweed and crustaceans, much to the pleasure of the dunlins. When the winds pick up, they stir up the sediment, which is rich in amber. On the morning after the storm, Intsmidnis, head of the Papa Lake Nature Reserve, sets out to uphold an age-old tradition. Using a landing net, he fishes seaweed out of the drift line, in which, he hopes, his booty has also become trapped. Ints is in luck. Amber was once a valuable trading article and stood for wealth and power. The Baltic gold was formed from the resin that used to flow from prehistoric trees. The subtropical climate has been a thing of the past for the last 40 million years. It's turned cold. Winter has arrived. Snow now covers the Baltic coast. The woods beyond the dunes have new visitors from Russia. When it gets too chilly over there, great grey owls migrate to the Baltic. From its vantage point, the owl can even hear mice scurrying about under half a meter of snow. The striking garland of feathers concentrates sounds and channels them to the owl's sensitive ears. The great grey owl hunts even by day. Its soft, fringed feathers enable it to fly almost silently, even if it's only to take up a better vantage point. From Cape Kolka in Latvia to the Estonian island world, the Baltic Sea is now freezing over almost completely. February. In many places, the sea has been replaced by stacks of pack ice. Below lie the grey seals' nurseries, sheltered from the icy wind. Thanks to this trick, grey seals can give birth even in the Arctic Ocean. Their presence in the Estonian Baltic is the most southerly in the world. The mother seal has been away hunting for hours. Well camouflaged by its white fur, the pup waits for her return. As soon as the mother pops her head out of the ice, the pup slithers off. It's hungry. The mother seal is busy keeping her breathing hole open. Suddenly, the baby falls in. A potentially lethal situation. The pup's coat is not yet waterproof, and it has also not yet eaten enough to provide a layer of insulating fat. Fortunately, it's sufficiently strong to clamber out again by itself. The mother uses her powerful claws to keep the hole open, even though the surrounding ice is more than 2 meters thick. Due to global warming, in some years the ice on the Baltic Sea melts earlier, a dangerous development for the seals. If the ice disappears too quickly, the pups will freeze to death in the icy water. Mother seals suckle their young for 5 to 8 weeks with extremely nutritious milk. The pups put on 2 kilos a day. Their growth is a race against time. As soon as the ice melts, they'll have to look after themselves. To the north of the island of Saaremaa, the Baltic stays ice-free. The cliffs and craggy bays of the coast, the broad beaches and wooded dunes are blanketed in snow and will remain so until well into spring. In winter, a nursery for polar animals. In summer, a breeding ground for southern Europeans. In all seasons, the coasts of the Baltic are a paradise for rare animals.